thank you so much for inviting me here. And welcome to Secretary Laird. We are two banana slugs amidst a lot of anteaters, I think. I've never had an experience like this. I want to say that the presentations earlier today provoked a number of reactions from me. I think one is just how proud I am of the University of California. And I am happy that we perhaps have turned the corner on the erosion of the university. And we have a long way to go, but really proud of the work that you all are doing. And the other thing is that I wish my wife were here because she is on the State Water Resources Control Board. And so I know that she would have been fascinated by all of this. She may well know about a good deal of this, but it's really, really work that matters a lot. And so it makes me especially proud also to be a Southern Californian because I think we are leading the way in so many respects when it comes to water. But I'm going to talk about that big body of water to our west this afternoon, and specifically about the Marine Life Protection Act initiative. I believe you heard a brief history of that last year from Michael Mantell, the founder of our organization at the Resources Law Group, where I'm a program officer for Ocean Coasts and Fisheries. And I didn't know 8 years ago whether or not I would ever be able to say this, but we have a statewide network of marine protected areas. And you probably have heard about the effort, and at times quite controversial. But it all started off here in the Central Coast, which is Secretary Laird's habitat. And this area was designated in 2007. All told now, we have 124 marine protected areas covering 849 square miles. And that's about 16% of California state waters. And about 9% of our state waters are now in what are called no-take marine reserves. Those are areas where no fishing, no taking is allowed. Other areas have restrictions of one sort or another on the kind of fishing that can be undertaken there. But after an initial effort on the North Central Coast, the North Central Coast was the next one after the Central Coast. And then Southern California went into effect in 2010, and just this year, the Fish and Game Commission approved a network on the North Coast that will go into effect more than likely on January 1st. And if there's one thing that this whole effort reinforced for me is how diverse this state is. And the process that we helped design and helped advance had to adapt from region to region. And it's a truism that there are these very, very great differences. What would work in, let's say, Laguna Beach is not going to work up in Eureka, and for a lot of different reasons. So once again, it impressed me just how diverse our social and political life here is in California, as well as the ocean life that we care about. So here we are down in Southern California, of course. And earlier, there had been a set of marine reserves established at the Channel Islands. And that was those were established in 2003 in state waters, and then the federal government followed with extending them into federal waters. This was really the first network in California. But through the MPA design process of the Marine Life Protection Act, other reserves and marine protected areas were added in Southern California. And one of the ideas behind the Marine Life Protection Act, which was passed in 1999, better than 13 years ago now, was the notion of a network. And one of the fundamental aspects of this notion is that individual marine protected areas should function as a network. That is, in the clearest example, that fish may reproduce and release eggs and larvae in one area, and they will be carried by the currents into another area, so that you have this overall network effect. And so if you look to the north, basically in the middle, we have two major areas here that are important for keeping this network together. And just as I happen to live right about there. And the problem here that is we're going to really be testing whether or not this network is going to function as a network is here at Point Vicente, because the habitat there isn't quite as rich as the habitat just to the north at Rocky Point. So this is all, it's much less engineering, much more art and interpretation and qualitative judgments. But this is nonetheless a really remarkable network, and I think, in particular right here, Orange County should be very proud and happy with the network that it has here off Laguna. I'm going to try to give you a sense of some of the benefits and opportunities of marine protected areas, both in terms of marine protected areas themselves, but also more broadly what it means for understanding and protecting our oceans. And one of the clearest reasons for establishing marine protected areas, in particular marine reserves where there is no take, is to provide an opportunity for fish populations in that area to recover. Here is a giant sea bass, grow to 500, 600 pounds. They're very residential. They don't move around a lot. And so they are very easy to catch. But here you can see just the last 50 years of the last century with commercial catches here in pounds and then recreational catches here in numbers of fish. It used to be that you could go off of the pier at Santa Monica and catch giant sea bass. And I don't know when a giant sea bass has been seen there since then. And as you can see, these are really massive fish. The good news is kind of one of the most popular aspects of or arguments for marine protected areas, big old fat female fish, or BOFs. And it turns out that quite contrary to our own experience, the older a fish gets, the more productive it is. And this is not just a little bit more productive. It is a lot more productive. And so the idea is if you keep these big fish in the water and allow them to grow and the small ones to grow to big fish in these small areas, they will be producing lots of eggs. But more importantly, or as importantly, once a fish gets this size, this is a vermilion rockfish, their larvae are more robust than the larvae of old, of younger fish. So in any event, that's part of the promise of marine protected areas. But in order for marine protected areas to work, they have to be implemented properly. And so one of the things that we did at the Resources Legacy Fund Foundation, with whom we work, is to ask a group called Blue Earth Consultants to look at how MPAs are implemented around the world and distill some of the best practices. What do you really need to do to make sure that these areas work? And you can see the five basic elements that they identified, and I'll just go through each one of those quickly. First of all, with the legal framework, California has a really strong legal framework because of the Marine Life Protection Act. It's probably one of the best pieces of marine legislation I know of, certainly. You need a strong management plan, and it's just like anything. You really need to be able to chart out a course, be able to identify when you're on course or you're off course. You need operational capacity. You need to be able to carry out enforcement, monitoring, education and outreach, all of those functions. And one thing that is often overlooked is that you need social capital. And social capital is really kind of a soft capacity, but it is absolutely critical to the success of these areas. And then here's the holy grail, long-term financial sustainability. And my only comment here is that the Marine Life Protection Act and our statewide network and everything that's been done with it grew up in a time of scarcity. So I think we're a pretty tough, lean bunch. We aren't thinking big thoughts about all the many, many things that we could do. We're really thinking about what do we need to do to get the job done. So one of the first things is monitoring. And we have been working very, very hard to advance effective monitoring of the statewide network. And this is a rare thing. Many, many protected areas don't have this kind of focus on monitoring. And the monitoring is critical not just because you're generating data, but because you are informing management. And that's a trick. That's not easy to do. And the other piece with monitoring of marine protected areas is we're really taking an ecosystem approach. It is really trying to identify what are those pieces of the ecosystem that you can look at and identify how well it's doing. But there's another piece of it, which is to evaluate how well the marine protected areas were designed. The first step of this is to develop a monitoring plan. And in this, in California, it was done a little bit differently than it's been done in many other places, because it wasn't simply a matter of the scientific community sitting down and thinking through how would you monitor these MPAs. Instead, the monitoring enterprise brought in fishermen, conservationists, divers, the people who are really going to want to know how this, and managers, how this is actually going to take place. And what's important. So the first plan was adopted on the North Central Coast in April 2010. The South Coast planning, this is a little out of date, is actually in place now. The North Coast is, the planning of for the monitoring plan is getting underway. And interestingly, the Central Coast, that first network, is going to be entering its first review, which is required after 5 years. So that's all part of adaptive management. So in that 5-year review, scientists, stakeholders, managers will look at what the data shows and ask the question, do we need to make adjustments? And it may be adjustments in boundaries, it may be adjustments in regulations, it may be adjustments in monitoring. One of the other distinctive aspects of this is to make the information really interpretable, so to speak. And so really starting to play with, well, how would you communicate that clearly? And these are just two examples to try and give a sense of how well these areas are doing. So that is kind of the overall structure for monitoring. The next piece and final piece I really want to talk about is this really a nexus between monitoring, operational capacity, and something I talked about earlier, which was social capital. And social capital is partly about engagement of people in the work of implementation. And so here you can see photographs from one of the Fish and Game Commission hearings at which the South Coast MPAs were being discussed. And you can see there were dozens and dozens and hundreds of people, young, old, students and not, who were very, very supportive of getting these MPAs established. So one of the challenges we've taken on is how do you take this enthusiasm and dedication and move it into helping with implementation? And I'll give you just two examples. One example is Reef Check California, which has been operating for several years. These are volunteer divers who have been trained to go out and collect information in a systematic fashion. Their protocol was established with universities in California, with the Department of Fish and Game. So it's pretty solid information. The interesting thing is that there are lots of divers who are willing to pay to get trained to do this and then paid to go out on a boat to do surveys, partly because it's a different kind of diving for them. And every year, a couple of hundred divers are trained from who go out and do dive surveys at 75 sites along the California coast. These are all volunteers. I want to talk about another reef check, this one down in Baja, but I want to tie it into something that's broader than marine protected areas, and that's the problems of hypoxic events, these low oxygen events that have been occurring with apparently greater frequency off the coast. And these are just photos from two incidents off of Oregon and Northern California. And I'm going to take you down to Baja, where Isla Natividad, where a marine protected area was established some years ago. And it's a very small experimental marine protected area. But very early on, they recruited local fishermen to take reef check dive training and to go out and actually do surveys themselves of their reefs. And one of the things that they've encountered was in 2 years, there was a massive die-off of abalone. And the abalone were just shells. And what they found, interestingly, was that they then went out and put platforms out to determine what the recruitment of new abalone were in areas in the reserves and areas outside the reserves. And they found that actually the recruitment was much higher in the areas inside the reserves, suggesting that there's some resilience that's being conferred by the marine protected area. Then about 2 months after I learned about that, I learned about this incident up in Gersel Cove near Salt Point State Park near Fort Ross, where there had been a similar die-off. Similarly, the abalones were just basically empty shells. And the point I'm trying to make here is that this is really a large-scale phenomenon, and it was detected by volunteer divers. So this sort of capacity is, I think, really important. The only other example I'm going to give is a new program that we've been supporting called MPA Watch, where volunteers are trained to collect information on activities they see inside and outside marine protected areas. Some of them collect that information from land, others collect it from the air. There's also information that's collected by boat. But one of the interesting things about this is that this is now about the only source of information on spatial distribution of human activities off the California coast. I'm sure the Navy knows some other things, but so these are volunteers, once again, doing this kind of work. So for us, going forward, the opportunities are to really expand our knowledge of local waters using marine protected areas as reference sites, as a lens, to learn more West Coast-wide about what's going on in terms of climate change and ocean acidification, But the other thing is that they are ways of getting people engaged with an ocean in a very specific way. And so we believe that that piece of it, that involvement by citizens, continues to be a critical element. So thank you once again for the opportunity to talk to you about this.